You are enjoying the conference?
Yes.
Are you enjoying the conference?
Yes.
I have only one slide. The only catch is I will be zooming in and zooming out. And this room is going to be really, really, really smelly because I know whose digestion is not doing good. Because I am going to talk about design smells, basic concept behind it, using some examples. So let's start. I'm going to start with Grady Booch. Everyone knows Grady Booch, I hope. He is the IBM fellow and wrote many books. He is a co-inventor of UML. Recently, he wrote this text and he put an analogy between cities, growing cities, and software systems, in which he says that from time to time, cities has to renew or refactor to meet the need of the populace. And the same, in a similar vein, software system has to also be refactored to meet the need of populace. I like this analogy a lot, and I thought let's dig a little deeper. So let's dig a little deeper. Yes, this is a map. This is a map where presently I live in Bangalore, and I'm going to tell you a couple of problems I face when I go from my home to my office. This is my home, and this is the 200 meter stretch that I need to cover to reach to this main outer ring road. And there used to be a very well-laid road, but due to rain and due to a lot of traffic, due to trucks and heavy trucks, that road is gone, and currently it looks like this. It's a muddy lane with a lot of potholes. Basically, the point is that the road should be there, there should be a road, but right now the road is missing. After some struggle, I come out from this lane and I go to the service lane, and then I reach to this particular point. There is an overbridge over here, and I need to take a U-turn to come out to the outer ring road. But the problem here is there is no traffic signal. The traffic signal is missing, and then what happens? Chaos happens. Everybody wants to go first, and you know, unnecessarily there is a traffic jam almost every time. That is, the underlying problem here is unrestricted access. There is no discipline over there. That's why it's happening. Then I come a little further, and then there is a signal, popularly known as totem pole signal, and I want to go from here to direct straight here. And again, from this particular point, I can take 8 different directions, 8 different turns. 8 legal. That's a good point. 8 legal point, turns I can take. And imagine now, then rest of the 8 also can take 8. So essentially, 8 multiplied by 9, 72 legal directions, legal turns you can take. It looks like to me a hub-like road. And actually what happened sometime back is one big truck broke down in the right here in the middle. And you can assume, you know, what happened. The whole traffic is jammed. Anyways, then I go a little further and I see a lot of traffic. And what people do, you know, some smart people, or I should be saying pseudo-smart people, they do like this. And And whenever I see it like this, I think in my mind, pause. This is footpath, this is for pedestrians, this is not a road. Footpath is not a road. But let's come to the point. Why I'm talking to you traffic problems? I promised you in the beginning that I'll be talking about design signals, but I'm talking to you traffic problems. Why? Is there any point? Yes, there is a point. What I want to say is every engineering discipline has to deal with non-optimal and sub-optimal solutions. And these solutions violate fundamental principles of that discipline. And those solutions, those non-optimal and sub-optimal solutions, are basically nothing but smells of that discipline. And since we are interested in software design, I would like to talk about design smell. So design smell, there is, I don't go in the definition design smell, the only two things has to be observed here, those are this, that they violate the fundamental design principle and they negatively impact design quality. Now let's connect the dots basically. I've shown you this missing road. If we talk about transport domain, road is a basic abstraction. And the road is missing, then the abstraction is missing. In the same way, if we use clumps of data or encoded strings instead of having a proper abstraction, then the abstraction is missing. That's basically missing abstraction design smell. Let's take an example. People from Java can identify this class much better. There is a class called Throwable in Java. And it provides a method called print stack trace. What it does? It basically dumps a string in standard output in which it contains information like file number, line number, which class it generated, exception message, things like that. So if you are writing, by the way, it's from Java 1, if you are writing a Java application, then basically you have to catch this string, parse it, use the information in maybe for logging or something like that. Now assume there are many people who might have written code to parse this string and then use it, that information in some or other way. And now suddenly the format of the string is changed. What will happen? All the application will break. That suggests us that possibly this design is not good. Something is missing here. Precisely, the abstraction is missing here. And Sun identified this problem in Java 1.4, and they corrected it. What they did, they introduced another abstraction called stack trace element. And they introduce another method called getStackTrace, and this abstraction actually providing all the details what you need. Now you need not parse that string and then, do whatever you want. Let's move on. Then the next problem I was talking about is related to unrestricted access. It's very analogous to deficient encapsulation. And what it is, if you have smell, that smell occurs when the declared accessibility of the members of an abstraction is much more than required. Again, let's take an example. This is point class in Java, and it has two members, X and Y. It provides getters and setters for X and Y. but interestingly it also declares as public. So you have multiple ways to get and set these numbers. Okay. Interestingly, this is not the only class in Java which has this problem. There are 508 classes in Java JDK 7 with at least one public field, and there are 96 classes which have at least five public fields. How many people know about this? Maybe you don't know. Okay. The next problem is hub-like role, which we see in that 72 legal directions you can take. Now assume the similar thing can happen in software also. That is called hub-like modularization. And when it will happen? When an abstraction has high fan in and high fan out. What it means is incoming dependencies and outgoing dependencies are both high, then we say this abstraction is suffering from hub-like modularization. Again, let's talk about an example. This is a component class in Java. This class is really nice class, more than 10,000 lines of code, and it has 498 incoming dependencies, 71 outgoing dependencies. But what, I mean, so what? The point is, if you change here, in this class, so all these 498 incoming dependencies may have to change. Similarly, if any of these 71 classes are changing, then you may need to relook at whether you need to change the component class or not. Right? Again, you don't want to do that, right? That's why this is a smell. By the way, there is one more class called font in Java. That class also suffering from hub-like modularization with high fan in and high fan out. This is again a problem. Let's suppose if the road is an abstraction in your design and footpath is another class abstraction in your design, then can you do like this? Then the road is a base class and footpath is your subclass? You can't. Can you do that? You can't do that because footpath is not a road. And every inheritance hierarchy has to satisfy the property is A. Right? And whenever the property is getting violated, that translates to broken hierarchy design smell. Let me tell you a very popular example. Many of you might be knowing already. Vector and stack. Stack is inherited from vector. What is the big deal? There is a big deal. Why? Vector is a random access data structure. You can access anything. You can anything and anywhere. But the stack is a LIFO. Last in, first out. Which means, what it means is, if you have an object or stack, then you can call any method from vector, and you can access anything from vector, any element in the list, which is violating the semantics of the abstraction. That's why it's a big deal. So actually, I'm coming to almost to my end of my talk. So the point which I want to convey to you is every engineering discipline has suboptimal and non-optimal solutions, but as engineers, we need to identify them, and software is not an exception. Software development is not an exception in that. In fact, it is more prone to such non-optimal and suboptimal solutions. Why? Because of intangible nature of the software. And the key message I would like to convey is design smells are important. You need to know them, you need to avoid them, and you need to refactor them. Here is the reference, all the examples and all the definition is taken from this book, and I'm one of the co-authors of this book. You can find more details here in this site, and these are my contact details. Please feel free to be in contact with me. And the first slide that I showed to you about Gary Booch, that is, he has written a foreword for this book. So the text is taken from the foreword of this book. That's it. Thank you. Do we have time for question? Question? Okay, we have. So anybody would like to ask a question? Okay, tools to detect smells. Yes, there are some, but not all the smells that we have described in this book. We have described 25 different smells, and there are some tools, for example, in C#, ndepend can detect, and for C++ and Java, there is a tool called Infusion that can detect. And there are many matrix tools also that can detect, in, not directly, but indirectly. So yes, but there are some tools, but still there is a gap, actually. There are many smells that we cannot detect today using present set of tools.
You may call such tools as nose. You may call such tools as noses.
No, I didn't get you, sorry.
So tools to detect smells.
Yeah.
Should be probably called noses.
Exactly. Nose. Or maybe dog's nose. Yeah. Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you.